And you will be noted as a saint because we are responsible to declare that to our future generation. But let me tell you a secret. If you don't do it, you're losing the ball game, because all of the history of all of the people in the world, where they have put up models and role models and paradigms for themselves, they have put it up out of their contemporary history to reflect upon so that they can act upon the quality and attributes that emanate from these beings. Y'all understand what I'm saying? So we can take Martin Luther King, not the model of Martin that the cracker has given us, the model of Martin that we know, and make him a deity or an orisha or saint, whatever we want to call it, so that our kids understand what we mean when we say do a king thing. All right? We take Fannie Lou Hamer and let her become the goddess of political organization or organizing. So when you tell people, get down with Fannie Lou, they know, get your political organizing strategy together, Negro. Okay? But we need to create the social language and the socializing paradigms for ourselves. And no one has had the greatness as the Africans in North America, because our situation forced us to have to be that great. But we have not been using the very things that the ancestors gave to us. He worried about what is a good woman. There ain't no community that got models like we got. No communities. You can go from the slave shack to the tenement. And no community. My mama is, how old is her name now? About 70, what, 6, 77? I never know this lady's name. Went over this morning to give her a plane ticket. First thing she does, go in her wallet, go give me some of my money back. But I said, no, 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 I don't need it. She goes, James. I go, like, I'm going to groan now. Don't be yelling at me like that. I'm not going to take your money. And she goes, but this woman, when I first met this woman, she was working, cooking in the kitchen of George Vanderbilt on Acadia Plantation. And that ain't no easy thing to work like that for crackers. On them plantations, this was a real working plantation. I wasn't on a ceremonial Williamsburg. This was a working plantation. I got up at 4 o'clock every morning and worked in the cracker field, and then came home, I had a little breakfast, and went to school. When I left home at 18, I was making, for working 6 days a week, $11.50. Okay? And I'm not that old to the earth, so this still goes on. You know? But my mother, the reason, this woman, she had 12 kids. First husband was Brother Ernest Green. Second husband was my daddy. Don't even know his name. Scared to ask my mama. I remember when he left my mama, I was about 2. And he left my mother because he hit my mother. And my grandfather kicked his behind, and that was the end of that relationship, because you couldn't hit Papa's baby, because that was his only girl, too. So he threw my daddy out. I remember crying, walking around that bed all morning with that hat. He gave me the little green hat. He was a carpenter. And when Mama cut that hat off, I had an absolute fit. And then she married my stepfather. Now, my stepfather was the baddest dude in the world. Dr. Jeffries got to know Paul before he died. Any black man that's going to marry some woman with 12 children is the baddest dude in the world. Right? The baddest dude in the world. But this man married my mama with all of these children and helped to raise all of the children. And this woman, who was making about $25 a week cooking in these crackers' kitchen, worked her way through beauty school, driving about 40 miles every day before she went to work in the afternoon, and then came to New York and got a job in a beauty parlor downtown, not doing hand of things because we didn't have no money to set her up. So she was washing the brush and the comb and hanging the coats up in the white shop or making some money, but make enough money to send my daddy to RCA Electronics School, you understand, then bring him on up here, and then to slowly bring us up here. But when I got up here, I met a woman already hooked up in Following Malcolm. You understand? Already hooked up in the movement. She couldn't see her children doing anything else, even though some of us have gone astray from it. And I remember when I became the minister of Muslim Mosque Inc., she came and became my cook. Now, it took me a long time to figure out, but mama was real slick. Didn't nobody gonna poison my baby, because she cooked all of his food, right? She cooked all of my food. I didn't think of that then. I just thought she wanted to be around to make sure, you know, what was going on. But no, she said, fool, I know if you eat my food, you was all right. This is a little lady who finished the ninth grade, because in those days you didn't get to no 12th grade down there, ninth grade. But you have seen her probably thousands of times, because any rally or happening in Harlem, she there. And when we go to Malcolm's grave, she bobbling there. You know, I remember when she was this figurative, beautiful, smooth-skinned, big afro lady. Now she's a little bent over and her face is wrinkled and her hair is gray. She still got her afro. And she's still going to the same places that she was going to then. This woman from the plantation who was born when there was no electric light and nobody had no TV and nobody had no radios and none of that thing, that is still there now, understanding Africa, understanding why I got to do what I got to do, have never, ever tugged me back. Ever, ever, ever. The most powerful thing we have in this race is the African woman. But the person who knows at least sometimes is you, the African woman herself. There can be no nation unless the woman understand the nature of your African womanness and explain it to us, because we need to understand it, but we can only understand it from you.
That's right.
That's very important. Because I'm fighting for the liberation of African people. I'm not fighting for the liberation of imitation European people. I'm fighting for the restoration. For the restoration of a human state that I truly believe that all people could live in if the African ideological perspective or philosophical perspective on how to deal with nature is the operative method for behavior. And only the African has proven with their Native American brothers and sisters and some Southern Asian brothers and sisters that they have the history to be in charge of such a system. And I know that sounds a little arrogant, but I'm really just trying to be historically honest. So I thank you for allowing me to impact on your ears, to impact on your psyche, to impact on your spirit. I hope that some of what I said have some usefulness in how we go forward. Reparations is absolutely necessary. But claiming the land, both here and at home, is absolutely necessary. Reanalyze it, Africa, so we don't fool ourselves to think something's going on that it's not going on. Africa needs to be liberated, and it needs to be liberated by African thinking people. That doesn't mean we go arrogantly to the continent telling brothers and sisters they don't know what they're doing. It means we create the kind of revolutionary relationships so that we assist them and they assist us in the worldwide liberation process for African peoples. Thank you very much. Okay.
I'm hearing Dr. Small, and I thought that that was just his usual presentation. It was absolutely dynamite. But I think being within Cobra and around people who are serious about reparations really bring out the best in people, because you should have heard our politicians last night. I'm sure they don't get a chance to talk like that often. I think they felt very, very liberated last night with this group. And that's the kind of influence that we must have on our people all over this country.
They are dying for this message. And it's not a hard message to put out there. Some of our people say, well, you know, they're always so skeptical about it. But mostly I find that our people welcome this message when it is presented to them in a way that is meaningful to them. And reparations is absolutely meaningful to all of our people, no matter what their condition, everything they can come up and talk about, it's a reparation story. Just like they say, that's a Kodak moment. Every time these people sit me down and start running their stories on me, it sounds like a reparation story to me. And I show them just how it fits in with what they're talking about and what they're involved in. You have been an absolutely serious bunch of conferees, and I just think that you should give yourself a round of applause.